Yep. Yeah.
That's better.
Yeah. Just so you know, we moved the blue mark to the floor.
Good morning, everybody. Those of you who are joining us on Zoom, on site, and online. This is the same thing we had Wednesday night. I don't know what is being hit, but something.
So I apologize for
the crinkling. I think it's my microphone. We'll figure that out at some point. It is good to have you with us, whether you're joining us on site or online. Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship by listening to the prelude. Please stand as you are able. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who journeys with us these 40 days and sustains us with the gift of grace. Amen. Let us acknowledge before God and one another our need for repentance and God's mercy. Holy God, we confess to you our faults and failings. Too often we neglect and do not trust your holy word. We take for ourselves instead of giving to others. We spoil rather than steward your creation. We cause hurt though you call us to heal. We choose fear over compassion. Forgive us. Renew us and lead us as we seek to follow in your way of life. Amen. Hear the good news. God so loved the world that God gave the only Son so that all may receive life. This promise is for you. God embraces you with divine mercy, forgives you in Christ's name, and revives you in the Spirit's power. Amen. Let us sing together our gathering song, Jesus, Friend of Sinners.
There is a voice that must be heard. There is a song that must be sung. There is a hope that must be lifted high. There is a treasure more than gold. There is a king upon the throne. There is one whose praise will fill the skies. His name is Jesus, Friend of Sinners. Jesus, Jesus, Friend of Mine. There's a peace. A peace that calms our fears. There is a love stronger than death. There is a hope that goes beyond the grave. There is a friend who won't let go. There is a heart that beats for you. There is a name by which we are saved.
Let us pray. Almighty God, your Son came into the world to free us all from sin and death. Breathe upon us the power of your Spirit, that we may be raised to new life in Christ and serve you in righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated for our reading.
Our first reading from Ezekiel. The hand of the Lord came upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me down in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me all around them. There were many lying in the valley, and they were very dry. He said to me, "Mortal, can these bones live?" I answered, "O Lord God, you know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, 'O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, I will cause breath to enter you and you shall live. I will lay sinews on you and will cause flesh to come upon you and cover you with skin and put breath in you, and you shall live. And you shall know that I am the Lord.' So I prophesied as I had been commanded. And as I prophesied, suddenly there was a noise, a rattling. And the bones came together, bone to its bone. I looked, and there were sinews on them, and flesh had come upon them, and skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, 'Prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, mortal, and say to the breath, Thus says the Lord God, Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live.' I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived, and they stood on their feet, a vast multitude. Then he said to me, 'Mortal, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, Our bones are dried up, and our hope is lost. We are cut off completely. Therefore, prophesy and say to them, Thus says the Lord God, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people, and I will bring you back to the land of Israel. And you shall know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people. I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live, and I will place you on your own soil. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken and will act, says the Lord." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our second reading from Romans. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not the flesh. You are the Spirit, since the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, He who raised Christ from the dead will give you life, will give life to your mortal bodies also through his Spirit that dwells in you. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
Please stand as you are able for the singing of the gospel acclamation.
Return to God with all your heart, the source of grace and mercy. Come seek the tender faithfulness of God. Return to God with all your heart, the source of grace and mercy. Come seek the tender faithfulness of God.
The Holy Gospel according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. Again, we have a long one. If you would like to be seated for the gospel reading, you may. Now, a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair. Her brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent a message to Jesus, "Lord, he whom you love is ill." But when Jesus heard it, he said, "This illness does not lead to death. Rather, it is for God's glory, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it." Accordingly, though Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, after having heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, "Let us go to Judea again." The disciples said to him, "Rabbi, the Judeans were just now trying to stone you, and you're going there again?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of daylight? Those who walk during the day do not stumble, because they see the light of the world. But those who walk at night stumble, because the light is not in them." After saying this, he told them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to awaken him." The disciples said to him, "Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will be all right." Jesus, however, had been speaking about his death, but they thought he was referring merely to sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." Thomas, who was called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in him, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do
Do you believe this? She said to him, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world. When she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary and told her privately, the teacher is here and is calling for you. And when she heard it, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come to the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. The Judeans who were with her in the house consoling her saw Mary get up quickly and go out. They followed her because they thought that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Judeans who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, where have you laid him? They said to him, Lord, come and see. Jesus began to weep. So the Judeans said, see how he loved him. But some of them said, could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying? Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, take away the stone. Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, Lord, already there is a stench, because he has been dead 4 days. Jesus said to her, did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God? So they took away the stone, and Jesus looked upward and said, Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me. When he had said this, he cried out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, unbind him and let him go. Many of the Judeans, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what Jesus did, believed in him. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. I invite our youth and young at heart forward at this time. How are you?
Good.
So that was a long story we just heard about Lazarus. So I'm going to tell the same story from the Story Bible so we can hear it again so we don't miss anything important. Three of Jesus' good friends included a man named Lazarus and his sisters Mary and Martha. Jesus was on a long journey when he found out that Lazarus was dying. It took Jesus a few days to travel to see his sick friend. When Jesus arrived, he saw Lazarus's sister, Martha. She had some sad news. Jesus, Lazarus is dead, cried Martha. I wish you could have arrived earlier. You might have been able to save him. Jesus tried to comfort her. Martha, don't be sad. Lazarus will live again. Martha believed what Jesus said. Then Lazarus's other sister Mary came to greet Jesus. She wished Jesus had come sooner too. Jesus, if you had been here, Lazarus might still be alive. She wept. She also believed that Jesus could have healed her brother. Jesus was sad because Lazarus died too. He cried. And cried. Jesus, Martha and Mary went to the tomb where Lazarus was buried. Jesus told some people standing there, "Take the stone away from the tomb." The people were surprised at what Jesus said. Martha reminded Jesus that Lazarus had been dead for 4 days. They had already made the body ready for burial by wrapping it in special cloths, but Jesus knew what he was doing. He insisted that they open the tomb. When the heavy stone was rolled away, Jesus said, "Lazarus, come out." The people were frightened and amazed when Lazarus came out of the tomb. Since his hands and his feet were all wrapped up in the burial cloths, the people had to help Lazarus. When the people saw Lazarus alive again, they laughed and sang and danced. Many people that day believed that Jesus would bring new life to all people. And hopefully this story still can help us believe that Jesus brings about new life. Jesus doesn't promise that we'll never die. In fact, the opposite. But says that even though we will die, even though our bodies will stop breathing one day, God, you're six. Yeah. So you've been alive for 6 years and probably many more. Yeah. Gotcha. Okay. But regardless of how old or young we are, right, God loves us and promises that we can have eternal, abundant life and that death will not be the end of our story. What? God is alive. God is all around us, always with us, loving us. When we're grieving somebody that has died and when we're giving praise in good times, God's with us in it all and promises that death's not the end of any of our stories. Your great uncle? Yep. Great uncle died. Great uncle. Yeah. Yeah. People die. But we know that God still loves them and gives them eternal life with God always. Yeah. Yeah, we get those reminders that all of our loved ones have eternal life, right? A Santa. There you go. Thanks for coming up. Let us pray together. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. I'm going to cut right to the hard truth this morning. Death is a reality of human life. It is, in fact, right in the definition of the word mortal, that is, being subject to death. It is an inevitable fact of our existence, but that does not make it any easier to face for many of us. You see that hesitation in our language around death, how society tends to talk about it. Most of the time, we can't even seem to say the D word. We walk around the truth. We talk around the truth. We say, "He passed." Or, "We lost her," or, "They've moved on." There's lots of different euphemisms. And in this morning's gospel reading, though, from John, Jesus models speaking plainly about death. But that doesn't change the fact that death still stings. When a loved one dies, it hurts. And our grief can be felt in any myriad of ways, and the expressions of that grief can be intense and ongoing. Mary, Martha, and the crowd all point out the fact that Jesus could have prevented Lazarus's death. We hear that three times in the gospel reading this morning. And when I read that in this pericope, I tend to hear them as harsh, grief-fueled, heartbreaking accusations. You might have noticed that in how I read it, right? Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But as Jesus states upon first hearing of Lazarus's illness, the outcome of his illness, Jesus knows from the beginning, will not be death, that is permanent death. But rather, it is for God's glory. In the midst of Lazarus's illness, God will be glorified. He tells Martha that her brother will rise again. And she acknowledges that she believes in resurrection on the last day. But Jesus takes this opportunity of Lazarus's death to crack open, to expand on her and all of those gathered, their understanding of resurrection. This morning's pericope includes the final of Jesus' seven big signs in the Gospel of John, started with turning water into wine, and this seventh one, the raising of Lazarus. All of them are meant to help people understand that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and maybe begin to understand all of that entails. And the signs seem to have been doing just that. Even before the sign itself, even before Lazarus comes out of his tomb, Martha confesses that she believes Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world. And then Martha goes and tells Mary that Jesus has arrived. But even though Mary has experienced these same signs, Martha might have even confessed to her faith that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God. Mary is weighed down with grief. But so is Jesus. Jesus knows the rest of the story. Jesus knows what's going to happen at the tomb. Jesus knows that he does have the power not only to prevent Lazarus' death, as everybody seems to suggest, but has the power to resuscitate him. And yet, Jesus is still greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He himself even weeps over the death of his friend. It shows the power of grief, the power of his love, and how those two go together. He knows the bigger picture, but Jesus is still touched by the grief that accompanies the death of his beloved friend. But after expressing his grief, he then shows that resurrection changes everything. Now, technically, Lazarus was not resurrected. He was resuscitated, meaning that he would then die again, unlike Jesus, who will be the first resurrection and will not have to die again. But still,
His reality, Lazarus's reality, is changed when the resurrection and the life, that is Jesus, when Jesus intervenes. Not only is he called out of the tomb and unbound, but I like to imagine that he lives eternal, abundant life right there, right then. The only other time we see Lazarus in the rest of the Gospel of John, he is reclining at the dinner table with Jesus. That common image of the abundant life that God promises for us all, abiding together at a feast. Lazarus gets to experience that abundant life even before his resurrection, just with his resuscitation. He has experienced the weight of death and the glory of God in the resurrection and the life. And to experience that abundant life that God promises for us, we too need to be called out of our tomb. We too need to be unbound by the cloths of burial. There first must be death before there can be resurrection. And I'm not just talking about death of the physical body. There are other things that need to die in us as well. Sometimes we call it the old creature, or our sinfulness, that turning in on ourselves that make us focus on me, myself, and I, our selfishness, our individualism, all of that sin and brokenness needs to die so that we might experience the resurrected, abundant life. We see this all throughout our lives. We are given glimpses of abundant life, death making room for resurrection. If you're a gardener and you might be preparing to plant, it's that time of year, and what do? You literally bury a seed in the ground. In that act of burial, that acknowledgement of death, of lack of life, that it is not yet living, we get resurrection into a new plant. Or it might be that an old relationship needs to die, that you need to work through that grief and heartache before a new relationship can blossom and grow. A friend of mine, a colleague and seminary classmate, was serving a congregation that recently decided to close. They allowed themselves to die as a congregation in that form, but in that process, were able to bless another nonprofit homeless ministry in their community with the building. And then the money that they had received for the other assets, they were able to distribute and bring about new life all throughout their community. Their congregation, as they knew it, died, but new life was abundant through that death. Even here at Grace, as we have been living into the new reality of this after COVID world, we asked the question, are there any ministries that need to die, that the season is over and past, and that there is new life to be had by letting something go? Sometimes in our ministries, in our congregations, in our lives, things need to be put to death. We need to let them die. We need to let the season end, not just continue doing things the way we've always done them because that's easier. but trust that our God is a God of resurrection, and that out of those deaths can come new life. Now, I'm not suggesting that death is something to be idealized, but I would suggest that it does not need to be feared the way that we seem to fear death, because our God is bigger and stronger than even death itself. Our Savior, Jesus Christ, is the resurrection and life. And though we will experience death, little deaths throughout our time on this earth, and then ultimately our bodies will die, God promises that in the midst of that all, there will be resurrection and life. Life abundant for all of us. Amen. Please stand as you are able as we sing our song of the day, Graves to Gardens.
I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty grace, treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together, and every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. To show you my weakness, my failures and flaws, Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain is still God of the valley. Turn the morning. You turn. turn mourning to dancing. You turn beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one. You're the only one who can. Oh, there's nothing. Oh, there's nothing. Better than you, there's nothing. Better than you, Lord, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you. Oh, there's nothing. Oh, there's nothing. Better than you, there's nothing. Better than you, Lord, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you.
With the whole church, let us confess our faith with the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, through us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Sustained by God's mercy, let us pray for the church, the world, and all of creation. Breathed into us the breath of life. Enlighten your church, deepen our partnerships with our companion churches around the globe, and bless the work of missionaries who accompany them. Your Spirit brings life to creation. Enlighten the natural world and restore ecosystems in need of healing. Uplift prophetic voices that turn us to the needs of the soil beneath our feet and in the air all around. You redeem the world and its people. Free us from systems of oppression. Combine nations and societies from the sins of racism, sexism, and homophobia. Rise up leaders at all levels of government who work to promote the dignity of the human life.
Oh God, we call. Oh God, we call. From deep inside we yearn. From deep inside we yearn. From deep inside we yearn for you.
You weep when we sleep. You weep when we weep. Be present with those who grieve or who are touched by illness, especially those listed on our prayer list and those we name now aloud or silently. You hear us when we call to you. Deliver us from the depths of our despair and free us from the worries that bind us. You are the resurrection and the life. Even though we die, we will live. With thanksgiving, we remember all your saints now, who now live in your eternal love.
We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting in your steadfast love and your promise to renew your whole creation. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
O God, we call. O God, we call. From deep inside we yearn. From deep inside we yearn. From deep inside we yearn for you.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share a sign of that peace with one another. Peace to those joining us on Zoom and on Facebook and YouTube. Each week during our worship, we take time to acknowledge that all we have is a gift from God, and we can use those gifts, our time, talents, and treasures, to do God's work in the world, to bring about enacting that abundant life, that resurrection here and now by the moving of the Spirit. We are thankful to all of the ways that you partner here at Grace to fulfill our ministries, where we strive to be servants to all people. We're especially thankful for one-time and sustaining gifts of any size. Those financial gifts can be given here in person or electronically. There is information on our website, in the bulletin, and in the chat about how to give. Keeping all of those gifts in mind, though, I invite Faith to pray our offering prayer.
Please stand as you're able. Let us pray. God of good gifts, receive these and all offerings as we present them in faithful service for the sake of your gospel. Prepare our hearts to receive you in this meal as you pour out your very presence through Christ Jesus, the wellspring of eternal life. Amen.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. Holy God, our living water and our merciful guide, together with rivers and seas, wells and springs, we bless and magnify you. You led your people Israel through the desert and provided them water from the rock. We praise you for Christ, our rock and our water, who joined us in our desert, pouring out his life for the world. The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his life, death, and resurrection, we await your salvation for all this thirsty world. Pour out your spirit on this holy food and on all the baptized gathered for this feast. Wash away our sin, that we may be revived for our journey by the love of Christ. Through him, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, both now and forever. Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial. And deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Come and receive Jesus, our strength in the wilderness. For those of you who will be communing from your homes or from your pews, the body of Christ given for you, the blood of Christ shed for you.
Give us bread for the journey, give us bread. Give us bread for the journey, give us bread. When our legs are getting heavy and we're hanging down our heads, give us bread for the journey, give us bread. Guide our way as we travel, guide our way. Where we go is hard to say. Guide our way as we travel. Guide our way. Make us one with each other. Make us one. Make us one with each other. Make us one. All the walls we built around us, may we learn to tear them down. Make us one with each other. Make us one. Lead us home to the garden. Lead us home. Lead us home to the garden. Lead us home. Where we'll live with all creation. Find our place and never roam. Lead us home to the garden. Lead us home. Give us bread for the journey. Give us bread. Give us bread for the journey. Give us bread. When our legs are getting heavy and we're hanging down our heads, give us bread for the journey. Give us bread.
God, the giver of love, Christ, the resurrection and the life, and the Holy Spirit of rebirth, bless you in this Lenten journey. Amen. Amen. Are there any announcements for the good of the gathered, either on site or on Zoom? If you're on Zoom, we ask that you put a note in the chat so we know to spotlight you. Any in the sanctuary?
Hi, this is for
she's got the camera on.
Okay, cool. This is for Victor, and he wants to thank everybody for the prayers that you guys are sending his way, and continue praying as they deal with the aftermath of the death of his uncle and what's to come with it.
We will definitely keep you and your family in our prayers. Other announcements in the sanctuary. Morgan.
There is no bell choir practice this week, so no bell choir practice tomorrow. The following week, it will resume as normal.
Thanks. Today is the last day to drop off donations of toiletries, incontinence supplies, or feminine products for the Chesapeake We Care Resource Center as we wrap up our March Caring Madness collection. This week is also the last week of our Lenten soup suppers and midweek worship. So potluck soup supper is at 6:30 here in the fellowship hall, and then hybrid worship for holding evening prayer at 7:15 on site and online. That and all of the other Zoom logins for the various gatherings throughout the week are available on the news and upcoming events page under the calendar tab of our website, www.gracelutheranchesapeake.org. We are still in need of a number of readers for next Sunday to help us read the Passion. So if you are willing to be one of those readers, I would appreciate you seeing me today. Send me an email, give me a call tomorrow in the office so we can get you your script. See me after worship. And we will get that all taken care of. I need four more for the 8:30 worship. Any other announcements? Then let us rise as we are able in body or spirit and sing our sending song, Glorious Day.
To remind everyone about the Easter brunch on Easter Sunday, 9:45. We need sign-up sheet. We need sign-ups for set up, and clean up. And also, if you'd like to bring some, participate, there's a sign-up sheet for how many, your family, and how many, and what you'd like to bring. Thanks.
Now let us sing.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb. Was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb until I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave. Out of
peace. Remember the poor. Thanks be to God.